May the grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Good morning. I see that it is time for us to get started, but I do not see a choir in the back, and so I think we will wait just a couple more minutes because they will be processing in. So just talk amongst yourselves until we have a choir. Abby says, go ahead. So we're going to. Oh, okay. Well, we are so glad that you've all chosen to worship here with us today. We'd like to especially welcome those who might be visiting with us. If you would, please put your name and any information you'd like to share with us in the pad at the end of your pew, and that way we can learn a little more about who you are. Today is a special day in the life of the church. This is Pentecost Sunday, and so we are celebrating the gift of the Holy Spirit. We are also celebrating membership into the life of the church and celebrating our confirmation students who have gone through a long process of learning what they believe, and so we are celebrating with them today. We'd like to invite everybody to join us in the fellowship hall after the service for a light reception for a chance to congratulate these confirmation students. Next Sunday, June 16th, we will have one service here in the sanctuary at 10 o'clock. We will be celebrating Children's Sunday that day, so the whole service will be geared towards kids. So if you have any kids in your family that you'd like to invite, please bring them. If any children would like to participate in the leadership of the service, if you will, talk to me today, and we'll make sure that you will get a part in the leadership of the service. You'll notice an insert in your bulletin about our summer supper series. Looks something like this. The first one of those will be on June 23rd. This is an opportunity to go and have dinner at someone's house. And so if you would like to be a part of that, we're asking that you please sign up for that on the back of this insert and drop that in the offering plate as it comes your way. This is a great opportunity to get to know people that you may not have already had a chance to meet and just have good fellowship around the table. So please get those in if you're interested. Get those in as soon as you can. Also on Sunday, June 23rd, we will be starting a special adults Sunday school class during the Sunday school hour. That will be called Half Truths. They will be looking at a book by Adam Hamilton. It looks at things like God helps those who help themselves and other stuff you will not find in the Bible that maybe you've heard Christians talk about over time that are not in the Bible. So if you're interested in that, it will meet in the fellowship hall on June 23rd, and it will last throughout the summer. We are always feeding the community, body and soul, and this month we are collecting canned vegetables in the bench outside the fellowship hall. So if you would pick up an extra can of vegetables the next time you're in the grocery store and bring those for the food bank, that would be very much appreciated. We also have children going to junior camp this afternoon, so please keep them in your prayers. Abby is directing that camp. I'll be going just to kind of help out, but please pray for Abby and the kids that are going to that. We now have a choir, so let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship.
Thank you. Join with me as we tell the story of Pentecost. When the day of Pentecost had come, the disciples were all together in one place.
And suddenly there came a sound like the rush of a mighty wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting.
Divided tongues as a fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them.
All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability.
Praise the Lord.
The Lord's name be praised.
Let us pray. Holy Spirit, making life alive, moving in all things, root of all created being, cleansing the cosmos of every impurity, dissolving guilt and anointing wounds. You are lustrous and praiseworthy. You awaken and reawaken all that is. Please come freshly this hour and save us. Amen. You may be seated. I'd like to ask Britton King and the Zepkes if they would please come forward to make covenant with us. Just please come stand right here. That's great. Good to see you all. As many of you already know, Paul and Doris Zepke and Britton King, they have been worshiping with us regularly for a long, long time. The Zepkes, when they would come up during the summer from Florida, worshiped with us. Now they've moved here permanently, and they're coming from a Presbyterian church, which will transfer their letter. Britton King has moved here more recently from North Carolina, I believe, and has found a home here among this people and become a part of a Sunday school class. They were both in the most recent pastor's class, and both are now ready to commit to this congregation and become an official part of this fellowship. So we rejoice with them today, the Spirit working invisibly and visibly among us to weave us together. So Paul and Doris, I just have a couple questions for you first. Do you desire to transfer your letter and become members of this congregation? Will you join us in our ministry of worship and service to the larger community, will you? Britton, did you desire to reaffirm your faith in Jesus Christ, and do you trust Him as your Lord and Savior? Do you wish to become a part of this church and to join us in our ministry of worship and service to the world? Now a question for you, the congregation. Do you, as members of the Church of Jesus Christ, promise to guide and nurture these new members by word and deed, with love and prayer, encouraging them to know and follow Christ and to be faithful members of this church? Let us pray. Loving God, on this Sunday of Pentecost, we rejoice how your Spirit is at work. Thank you for sending the great life giver to us. And thank you for these persons who have come to this place to join the larger church in ministry. We thank you for their gifts, and we pray that you will help us to treasure them and make room for their use. We thank you for the blessing that the Zepkes and Britton are already to us, and we pray that we will be a blessing to them. In all things, may we serve Jesus Christ, show forth His love, and bring glory to your holy name. Through Jesus Christ our Savior. Amen. Let me be the first to welcome you all. And you all can join me downstairs following the service so others can learn. Our scripture reading today is from Paul's letter to the Romans, the 8th chapter, verses 9 through 27, page 1032 in your pew Bible, if you would like to follow along as the passage is read. Great chapter from Paul and a great chapter on the work of God's Spirit. Before we read together, let us pray. Holy Spirit, come and light your fire. Stir up in us faith, hope, and love. By your word, convince us of the good news so that we may live as those whom you have claimed, free and gladly. In Christ's name, amen. Romans 8, verse 9. Listen for the word of the Lord. But you are not in the flesh, you are in the Spirit, since the Spirit of God dwells in you. Anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, though the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is life because of righteousness. If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies also, through his Spirit that dwells in you. So then, brothers and sisters, we are debtors, not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh, for if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. For you did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received a spirit of adoption. When we cry, Abba, Father, it is that very Spirit bearing witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ, if in fact we suffer with him, so that we may also be glorified with him. I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory about to be revealed to us. For the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the children of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not of its own will, but by the will of the one who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be set free from its bondage to decay and will obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God. We know that the whole creation has been groaning in labor pains until now. And not only creation, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly while we wait for adoption, the redemption of our bodies. For in hope we were saved. Now hope that is seen is not hope, for who hopes for what is seen? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as we ought. But that very Spirit intercedes with sighs too deep for words. And God, who searches the heart, knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. Friends, this is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
In the Western world, the Holy Spirit is the least appreciated person of the Trinity. Some say the Spirit is getting least attention because the Spirit doesn't draw a lot of attention to himself, herself. The Spirit is always working behind the scenes, the logic goes. Well, Pentecost, of course, would be one huge exception to that, with the fire coming down and empowering the disciples to spread the word of Jesus Christ. But as a rule, the Spirit often works invisibly, nudging, whispering, guiding, empowering, and renewing in ways that aren't immediately obvious to us. Maybe if we Presbyterians loosened up a little bit, we might see more hoopla from the Spirit alive among us? Maybe. But there doesn't have to be a lot of hoopla for the Spirit to be at work. The Spirit goes to work for us every day. Hard work. Important work. Loving work. Grinding it out for our salvation. Let's listen to four things Paul tells us that the Spirit does for us. First, the Spirit gives us new life. Paul believed that there were two spheres, two worlds, two ages to which we might belong. One of these realms was the age of the flesh, and the other of these realms was the age of the Spirit. The age of the flesh was characterized by us going our own way, turning against God, turning in on ourselves, broken hearts, broken minds caused by sin, which all eventually leads to death. The age of the Spirit is characterized by divine forgiveness, healed relationships, upward and outward, getting a chance to breathe deep again, to let go of our brutal past, and to start fresh. And the age of the Spirit leads to new life. The Spirit is all about life. Nothing comes alive and stays alive without the creative work of God's Spirit. But what we're saying is the Spirit can even bring new life out of death. You remember the women went to the tomb on that Sunday morning, 3 days after the crucifixion, so that they could do something with the body of Jesus. And when they got to the tomb, it was empty. The Spirit provided resurrection for us. The Spirit, whom we adore, along with God the Father and God the Son, created new life out of death. And this same Spirit is resolved to grab us by the lapels and yank us out of the grave. Whenever you see a second chance being born, somebody on a fresh start, somebody or some church getting its life back, whenever someone comes out of rehab with their head held higher than they've held it in years, whenever light finds us in the darkness, or a person dies with hope in her eyes, that's the work of the Spirit. And we who believe in Jesus Christ, we belong to the age of the Spirit. Some of you will remember Fanny Dugan, who is a member of this congregation. She actually attended the early worship service. Fanny, when she was a little girl, needed very much to be adopted. And she wasn't sure she was going to make it. She lost both of her parents during the flu epidemic of 1918, which ravaged the country. And from there, because nobody in her family could or would take her, she wound up at Holston Home. She was always extremely grateful for that place, but the way they went about adoption in those days was so stressful. When they knew that the kids... When the couples were coming to choose children to take home with them, the kids would scramble to get cleaned up and dressed, and then they would line up in a row. The couples then would pass through to make their choices. And every kid had his or her finger crossed. Every child saying on the inside, "Pick me, pick me." Imagine what it would have been like to be one of those children who was not chosen. What would you think? What's wrong with me? Why won't somebody bring me home to love? Eventually, Fanny was adopted. Some never were. Well, God said, enough of that. If you want to be adopted, no problem. The Spirit is God's adoption agency. Finds us, claims us, makes us part of God's family in our baptism. In baptism, we have not received a spirit of slavery so that we fall back into fear. In baptism, we receive the spirit of adoption. God loves us after all. Wants to take us home and love us. So, whenever we're feeling lonely and isolated, whenever we wonder if anybody knows us or cares about us, when something tells us that we're not pretty enough or good enough or smart enough or charming enough to be accepted and approved, that's when we wind up and we punch those lying thoughts in the mouth. Because God says, you are mine, whatever you look like, however smart you are or are not, whether or not anybody else thinks you're charming, you are mine. The spirit of adoption in the sacrament of baptism. We don't have to be afraid anymore, not measuring up. So the Spirit gives us new life, the Spirit adopts us, and the Spirit helps us to see the future which belongs to God. You know, earlier we said that Paul believed in two spheres in which we might live, the era or age of the flesh, the era or age of the Spirit. These two worlds are opposed to each other, but in Paul's way of thinking, there's really no contest between the two. The Spirit age will win. The era of the Spirit will dominate, will come to pass. The kingdom has come, is coming, and will come. And that kingdom includes things like all things made new. Heaven and earth united as one. Whatever causes division in the world and heartache defeated, the very life of God, believe it or not, flowing through us and the whole creation. That's what's coming. The Spirit helps us see it. Of course, you can't see this with your eyes, but when the Spirit goes to work, it helps us to believe that the promise God makes to us is for real. And when we believe that God's future is on its way, then we have hope. Even in the toughest, roughest days, we see what can't yet be seen, and we hang in there. Our work and prayer draws energy from this promise. I heard a story about a domestic worker in the South from several decades ago. She barely made enough to get by, had several children. She did tell them that education was very important and lived as such. When it came time for her oldest child to go to school, go to college, somehow she had pinched pennies and had enough resources to pay for room, board, and tuition. Somebody asked her, how did you manage to save for your kid's education? She said, I saw a new day coming. We see a new day coming. And so that gives us hope. And it helps us to strain and to yearn and to work toward that new day because we're sure of it. A new day's coming. Spirit helps us see and believe. If you're like me, you've had days when you've approached God's altar to pray and you just didn't have the words. The burdens were too heavy, the confusion too deep. About all you could do was turn to God and sigh. Well, according to Paul, when we don't have the words to pray, the Spirit prays for us. The Spirit travels through us like the wind travels through the trees, leaving no leaf unturned. The Spirit knows us even better than we know ourselves, knows what to ask for, even when we can't name it for ourselves. And then this Spirit, which comes from God and knows our depths, takes our deep concerns into the deepness of God. And do you know what that means? We're heard. We speak not a word, and we're heard. The word for spirit is also the word for breath. So we breathe in deeply God's Spirit, which searches us from head to toe. We breathe out, and the Spirit goes to the depths of God to intercede for us. We have come to words in Paul that are some of the best that have ever been written. Words of grace and comfort. The next time your prayer can only be a sigh, take heart. Because the Spirit knows you and prays for you. The Spirit goes to work for us every day, providing new life, making sure that we are adopted into God's family, giving us confidence in God's coming future, and praying for us with sighs too deep for words. I wonder if you would join me in prayer now on this Pentecost Sunday, at your own pace and at your own volume, saying and repeating, "Come, Holy Spirit." Let us pray for a few moments. Come, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit, to us. Please come, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit. Let all God's people say, "Amen."
Will you come and follow me if I but call your name?
seated. Our confirmands, Andrew Rouse, Grace Lampe, Jack Lampe, Riley Ray. This is what the wind has blown up among us, sometimes around us, sometimes in spite of us, sometimes through us. And here they are getting ready to confirm once again, or us to confirm that miracle of faith that happens in and through the church. Confirmands, we rejoice that you now desire to declare your faith and to share with us in our common ministry. In baptism, you were joined to Christ and made a participant of His church, the household of faith. In the community of God's people, you have learned of God's love for you. You've been nurtured at the table of our Lord and called to share the love of Jesus Christ with others. Hear once again these words from Jesus Christ. You are the light of the world. A city built on a hill cannot be hid. No one after lighting a lamp puts it under the bushel basket, but on the lampstand, and it gives light to all the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. Now, as you publicly declare your faith, I ask you to reject sin, to profess your faith in Jesus Christ, and to confess the faith of the church, the faith in which you were baptized. Andrew, do you turn from sin, acknowledge your need for forgiveness, and turn to Jesus Christ?
I do.
Who is your Lord and Savior?
Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior.
Will you be His faithful follower, showing His love and obeying His word?
I will with God's help.
Do you desire to join this church? Will you worship and serve with us and share your gifts of time, talent, and treasure?
I will.
Grace, do you turn from sin, acknowledge your need for forgiveness, and turn to Jesus Christ?
I do.
Who is your Lord and Savior?
Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior.
Will you be His faithful follower, showing His love and obeying His word?
I will with God's help.
Do you desire to join this church?
Will
you worship and serve with us and share your gifts of time, talent, and treasure?
I will.
Jack, do you turn from sin, acknowledge your need for forgiveness, and turn to Jesus Christ?
I do.
Who is your Lord and Savior?
Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior.
Will you be His faithful follower, showing His love and obeying His word?
I will with God's help.
Do you desire to join this church? Will
you
worship and serve with us and share your gifts of time, talent, and treasure?
I will.
Riley, do you turn from sin, acknowledge your need for forgiveness, and turn to Jesus Christ?
I do.
Who is your Lord and Savior?
Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior.
Will you be His faithful follower, showing His love and obeying His word? Do you desire to join this church?
I do.
Will you worship and serve with us and share your gifts of time, talent, and treasure?
I will.
Let us stand to say what we believe. I believe in God the Father Almighty,
maker of heaven and earth,
and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence He shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated.
Our confirmands have been working with their mentors since February to explore what the Christian faith means to them. And so now we'd like to give each mentor just a short amount of time to share a little bit about their experience.
Well, Riley and I have had a wonderful time. And one of the things we did, we walked to each of the seven churches one afternoon to give them information about the tobacco laureate. And I don't say that correctly, but anyway, it's the service held for all five high schools in Greeneville. The only religious service that is, you know, we can't have anything in schools anymore. So this gets all five high schools. And we walked to seven churches, and we talked to either the secretary or the minister or someone associated with that. And the Spirit moved one of the churches, Jamie, and they gave, they have never given before, to support this activity. And it's a wonderful thing. So if you ever have a chance to give to that service, it reaches lots of people. And that's what we did.
I was actually thrilled when I was asked to be Jack's mentor. Jack is a fine young man. He's willing to express his faith. He's willing to learn. And he does have a good sense of humor. We did make it through all of our lessons. And I will say this. I have worked with scouts for years, and I always tell the young men that no one can keep them from doing what they want to do. And the only person that can is that person that looks at them in the mirror in the morning. And I said, the sky's the limit. To which Jack replied, no, Mr. Love. He said, there's another universe out there. It was a pleasure to work with Jack. It's comforting to see the faith that these young people have. And as we were talking this morning, our church is in good hands.
I'll try to get through this. There are times that God sends special people into our lives just when we need it most. This was definitely a time when Grace was asked me to be her mentor. Grace's strong faith and her love for God, her family, her friends, it's great. She has always looked forward every week. I called it my Grace time when we met, because she was always such a blessing to me. And Grace, thank you for being such a positive influence on my life. And I come out of this journey with such hope for the future for all of us. Thank you.
And today I am standing in for Beverly Williams, who had a prior commitment and couldn't be here, but was Andrew's mentor. And so I want to tell everybody, I met with these confirmands weekly, and there was one particular week that Andrew arrived before everyone else, and so I had a chance to talk with him. And he said something that was so relatable. He said, you know, I used to sit in church, and I got a little bored. I couldn't focus. I just couldn't really connect with what was going on. But then one day, it just clicked. And I realized that what Jamie has to say is pretty deep. And, you know, Jamie just talked about the Spirit moving among us. When he was telling me that, I thought, there's no better way to describe the Spirit moving in our life than to just open our eyes and to just be able to hear things differently and to hear God speaking in them. So that day, Andrew taught the lesson to me, and thank you for that. Now I'd like to ask a question of the congregation. Do you, as members of the Church of Jesus Christ, promise to guide and nurture these new members by word and deed, with love and prayer, encouraging them to know and follow Christ and to be faithful members of His church?
We do.
Now I'd like to ask all mentors and parents to lay hands on your confirmand. Please join me in the litany found in your bulletin. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ.
By God's great mercy, Andrew, Grace, Jack, and Riley have been raised to new life through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead.
They have received an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for them.
They are being saved by the power of God.
With us, they are God's people, servants of Jesus Christ. Glory to God.
Amen and amen.
At this time, we would like to present each of you confirmands with a stole. These stoles were handmade just for you. Each one is unique, just as you are unique. Stoles are a symbol. I want you to. Stoles are a symbol that you have been set apart. Our God is not only a God who calls, but our God is also a God who sends. And so from this day forward, know that you are being sent by God to serve here in this place and to serve in the world.
Do good and share what you have, for such sacrifices are pleasing to God. With glad hearts, let us make our offering to the Lord. You may be seated. Will the elders who are coming forward to serve communion please come? Scriptures tell us they shall come from east and west, north and south, and sit down at table in the kingdom of heaven. And you're invited to the meal. So enjoy it. Revel in its goodness. Taste the love. Receive the grace offered freely to you through this cup and through this bread.
Let us pray together. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Holy God, it is our greatest honor and joy to give you praise. From the breath of life that you breathed into us, to the breath of the Holy Spirit that dwells within, our very beings are praises to you. When our hearts wandered, you called us back to you. When we have sinned, you have forgiven us. In the fullness of your time, you sent us your Son to dwell amongst us, that we might feel your love and forgiveness in flesh and blood. Yet we still turned from your love, hanging him on a cross, but your love prevailed. Holy and steadfast are you, O Lord. You raised Jesus from the grave and sent us the Holy Spirit, that we might be your people. You breathed life through the Spirit and gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. We gather this day together as your people around this your table, that we may remember your mighty acts. Here at this table, we gather as your community, filled with your Spirit, and as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ offering for us, as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We ask now that you pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, and on these gifts of bread and cup. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Hear us now as we lift our voices together in the prayer your Son taught us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
On the night of his arrest, our Lord Jesus was at table with his disciples, and after giving thanks, he took the bread, broke it, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, given for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood for the forgiveness of your sins. Whenever you drink this, do so in remembrance of me." Brothers and sisters, whenever we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes in power and glory. These are God's gifts for you, God's people. We have received grace. Let us be aware of those to whom we might be grace. These persons, please hold in your thoughts and prayers. Sandra McCamey, who is at home still taking treatments. Martha Long, at home now following surgery. Naomi Hackman, recovering in Johnson City. Also, the names of these persons who were given to us later in the week. Mary Little asks that we remember her sister-in-law, who's suffering from cancer, and Little Lyons. And also, Jack Berkey asks us to remember his family because his mother, Mary Moore, passed away on Friday, I believe it was. That funeral is tomorrow at 2 o'clock at Kaiser Rose Hill. Visitation is from 12 to 2. Again, that is tomorrow. We also rejoice with Gloria and Dwayne Fessenden, who celebrate their 70th anniversary, wedding anniversary, this weekend. Let us pray. O God, the presence of your Spirit has transformed our gathering into a feast of undeserved grace. We rejoice that your Spirit isn't locked up in here, but is out there where we are going, already at work to bring your goodness, life, and love to the world. Help us not to be afraid to join the Spirit in your holy work. Amen. You are of the Spirit, walk by the Spirit, live by the Spirit, show the Spirit of grace to everyone. And the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord be kind and gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and grant you peace. Let all God's people say, Amen.